Hi, my name is Surrage. I'm the Technical Development Manager here at Fargro, and today I'm going to be talking about biopesticides for the control of soft-bodied pests. So we're going to be looking kind of generally at things to keep in mind when applying these products. I'll obviously mention a few products, but it's kind of generalities that are important to keep in mind with biopesticides that you may not have had to think about with conventional chemistry. Obviously, with a lot of biopesticides, bioinsecticides, they tend to be based on living organisms, so generally entomopathogenic fungi. And as they're living organisms, you need to think about what environmental conditions they're going to need to thrive, same as you with the macrobiological controls, how you're going to actually contact the pest. So if the pest is hidden, if it's cryptic, how are you going to get to it? So what your application technique is going to look like, and things like tank mixes, as well as how to fit these products into a program. Obviously, if you're applying a biopesticide one day that's based on an entomopathogenic fungus, going in the next day with some fungicides may have some detrimental effects. So thinking about that side of things as well. So initially we just thought we'd set the scene a bit with what biopesticides and biocontrols are. So biocontrols is what Alex was speaking about earlier. So your predatory mites, parasitic wasps, predatory insects and nematodes, they set a really firm base for an IPM program. A lot of biopesticides are generally made up of microbials, so things like viruses, bacteria and fungal pathogens. So often the bioinsecticides will be based on entomopathogenic fungi, but there's quite a lot of biofungicides that are based on bacteria and fungi, and there's also a couple of bioinsecticide products that are based on viruses. There's also a range of biopesticides that are semiochemicals, so they're working through modes of action like mating disruption. So a good example is with product Isonet T, which is for the control of Tuta absoluta. Saturates the airs with pheromones, which means that Tuta absoluta can't find each other and mate, so you see a drop in population pressure. And then finally, natural products, so things like plant extracts, and some of your contact acting products such as Flipper, Tech Bomb fall into this, Flipper being derivative of the olive oil process. And there's some orange oil products that are produced from orange skin, so that's where your natural products sit. So what are the kind of things that we need to think about with our biopesticides? Well, mode of action is obviously very important. How is the product working? Is it contact? Is it going to have some systemic activity? What is the environment going to be? So what are the humidities and temperatures that we need to think about to get this product to work effectively? There's no point in applying the product if the environmental conditions aren't there to get it to work. Mixing, so is there any benefit to pre-mixing? Do you need an adjuvant? Spraying, so this kind of ties into some of the previous points, especially mode of action and where the product is. So spraying, how are you going to apply it to actually get to the pest? If it's hiding within the foliage, how are you going to go about that? And compatibilities, so from a tank mix perspective, are there products you can mix the biopesticide with? Are there products that are going to affect the biopesticide if you apply that product after you've applied, for example, an entomopathogenic fungus? These are all things you need to take into account to get the product to really work effectively for you. So as a kind of example, I thought we'd look at an entomopathogenic fungus called Bavaria bassiana. It's very popular and has been around for quite a while. So it's available as Neutralisel, which contains a specific strain ATCC74040. And there's also Botanicard, which has a Bavaria bassiana in it. You can see kind of how the product works on the right-hand side. So there you've got the Bavaria bassiana spores actually sporulating out of the insect body post-infection. So it's a relatively unique mode of action, very unlikely to develop any kind of resistance issues, and it's actually quite good on a range of different soft-bodied pests. Very effective in an IPM program, works well alongside macrobiological controls, and we've seen this product really work effectively and really rip through populations when the environmental conditions are correct. So let's look at the mode of action and how the product actually works. So you've got your Bavaria bassiana as Neutralis mixed with water in formulation. You're trying to get the spores of the product onto the insect, so to contact it directly. So that's a point to think about initially. What are the water volumes going to be for your specific crop, and how are you going to get that effectively onto the insect? Once the spores are on the insect, they then germinate and penetrate into the insect's body. And they do this through a series of enzymes and penetration pegs. So once they've done that, you have that proliferation of the mycelium and production of blood spores and multiplication within the hemolymph of the insect. So what the mycelium is doing is it's feeding on the hemolymph, using that nutrients to grow and keep developing, which is ultimately going to lead to the dehydration of the insect. After 3 to 5 days, you then see the insects beginning to die. So what's really important from a grower perspective when you're applying this product is you can't expect to have the same knockdown that you would with some of the conventional chemistry. Some of the things you can look out for will be a change in behaviour. So you will see the pest behaving strangely. Once the pest is infected, they'll stop feeding, they'll withdraw their stylet from feeding, they'll stop mating, so they won't actually be doing any damage, but they'll still sort of be wandering around, although they will be infected. Sometimes with some entomopathogenic fungus, you can see a colour change, especially in thrips, for example. But that's quite difficult to see, and you'd probably need at least a hand lens, if not a microscope, to see that colour change. So with Bavaria bassiana, as I mentioned earlier, there's quite a wide range of activity, so it's worthwhile having a look at that now. So whitefly, good efficacy on whitefly and thrips, both of those two are on the UK label. So you know it's working effectively on Trilorhodes, so glasshouse whitefly, as well as Bemisia, it's got efficacy, and also the honeysuckle whitefly. Thrips again, quite a range of thrip species that it's controlling. Mentioned there western flower thrips. But what's important to keep in mind is if you've got thrips that are particularly cryptic, so hiding in flower heads, it's going to be more difficult to get that control. So what's important to think about in that case is trying to use neutralis effectively at the right time when you've got low population pressures. If you've got the higher population pressures and the pest is cryptic, then it might be worth looking at something that has some systemic action to get to those cryptic positions. Spider mite, we know neutralis has good activity and Bavaria bassiana has good activity on spider mites across a range of different spider mites and also across a range of different life cycle stages, so adults, nymph and some oversidal activity. Again though, contact absolutely key with this product on all of these pests. Some independent trials have shown pretty good control of capsids, and there's been good data showing efficacy on aphids, caterpillar, leafhopper, a whole range of soft body pests. We at Fargro have seen a really good control in the correct environmental conditions of aphid, seeing it rip through populations. So yeah, it's a really good product to apply for a range of different soft-bodied insects. So something that's really key is the environment for activity. So what are the best conditions for getting Bavaria bassiana to work? So you'd want a temperature range between 10 and 37 degrees, so quite wide in its range. Obviously at the extremities it's going to have some effects but not be massively effective, so you're looking for that sweet spot in the middle of between 20 to 30 degrees. That's when the product's going to be most effective. So obviously at the moment where we've got some early aphid out and about, unless you're in a heated glasshouse where you've got those temperatures, temperature's going to be a really limiting factor at the minute. What's important also is to look at humidities. So the humidity range for the trials to work is from 50% to 100%. But over 60% is where it starts working quite effectively, and above that 80% is where you then start getting that external sporulation stage. So in some of the images where you've seen the white bodies coming out of the insects, that's when you've had humidity above 80% relative humidity. And what you can then get is what's called an epizootic infection. So those insects that have those sporulating bodies coming out of them are then going on to infect further insects, which can give you good control. And that's generally where we see neutralis work really effectively in rip-through populations. It's not something that should be relied upon because it's quite difficult to get to happen, but if it does happen, it can really give you really good effective control of the pest. So there is potentially some effect from direct UV light. So again, thinking about application timing, neutralis is in an oil dispersion formulation, which does give pretty good protection against UV light. But if you're going to apply the product in the morning, in the summer, and then the sun's going to come out, it's more than likely that any of the droplets with the spores on the leaf are probably going to be detrimentally affected by really bright sunlight. So thinking about maybe evening application, so you've got the humidity there, temperatures in the summer, and you're not going to have the effect from UV light, so evening application is a good bet. So with regards to application, something that's absolutely key for most of the bio pesticides, especially the fungal based ones, are making sure that your application equipment is clean. So if you've got a tank that you've previously used fungicides in, for example, it's likely there's going to be some residues within the tank or the spray lines that may affect the fungus. So triple rinsing is a good start, but we know that still leaves residues. Generally, it's best, if possible, to have a separate knapsack, for example, that you use your biopesticides through, just because then you're not going to have that effect. Before measuring your product out to its final volume, think about, well, definitely do rotate the bottle, especially if you've had it in storage for quite a while. You can often get the elements separate out, so if you rotate it, it'll just make sure it's mixed all properly, so you're getting the right amount of colony forming units into your spray mix. The general concepts of mixing will apply, so making up an initial solution in half the final water volume. Once completely dispersed, make up the final volume in water. So again, making sure that you're getting that good agitation so that spores are properly dispersed throughout the mixture, and that continues throughout the process. So similarly to your nematodes, if you're used to using those, you've got to make sure you're agitating the tank. If you're spraying for quite a long time, then they are going to settle out. So making sure you've got that agitation is absolutely key. With neutralis, specifically because it's an oil formulation, a wetter is not needed. But obviously for other formulations, it's worthwhile looking at what the manufacturer suggests. So continuing with application, something that can be quite important for biopesticides, especially the entomopathogenic fungi or any fungal product, is pre-mixing or spore activation, so soaking the product. There's often quite a lot of benefit to doing this. So with Bavaria bassiana, mixing the active ingredient with a small quantity of water and then leaving it for 2 to 3 hours will just give time to the product to wake up, start germinating before you actually go out and apply it. Something that's important to remember with this process is you don't want to be mixing neutralis or Bavaria bassiana into hot water. You want it to kind of be tepid, lukewarm water, so not cold but not hot. If you mix it into cold water, it's going to remain relatively dormant. And if you mix it into hot water, there's a really big potential once you start getting above 40 degrees that you're going to denature the product and it's not going to work effectively. So kind of tepid water is very important. And what's also quite important as well is to make sure you don't leave it to soak for too long. So over 5 hours, you'll start getting the spores very liable to damage, especially if they're going through spray lines. So making sure you're soaking for the right amount of time in the right temperature of water is really key to getting this product to work effectively. So when do we want to use a product like Naturalis? Well, it's really important to use at the first sign of pests. So making sure you're crop walking and monitoring regularly is very, very important to get the best out of most biopesticides. They work effectively at low population pressures generally. We have seen some very good cases of them working really well at high population pressures, but generally the lower the population pressure, the better it's going to be. Type of spray, so thinking about what quality of spray you want to get good contact, so generally a fine spray to ensure there's good coverage is important. And timing of application, which we've kind of briefly looked at, potentially looking at either in the morning or the evening when relative humidities are higher and adults are flying less. An interval between sprays of 5 days. So we have seen some cases, especially where you've got layering of pests, so layering of white fly or aphid, for example, having those kind of back-to-back applications after 5 days is really key for getting proper knockdown to kind of below an economic damage threshold. So that can be quite important with the product as well. So points that can be quite important to think about, especially with biopesticides, is things like shelf life and compatibilities. So when you get the product in, do check on what its shelf life is going to be. So in the trialers, for example, that has 12-month shelf life at 20 degrees. So realistically, you've got a season to use the product, and that is how you want to use these products. They don't store as well as conventional chemistry did. To maintain the maximum spore viability, you should be looking at storing it in essentially a fridge. So at Fargro, we have a very large chemical fridge where we keep these products. So when it's come from us, you can know it's been stored in that condition. So it does have 12 months at 20 degrees, so there's no need to put it in the fridge, as it were. But if possible, that is going to mean you've got the maximum spore viability. When opened, so once you've opened it, humidity can get in there, so you would want to be storing it at that point at 4 to 7 degrees. So if possible, I know this isn't always possible in a lot of situations, but if you don't have that facility, then using your whole bottle of Naturalis at once is going to be an effective way of making sure that the spore viability is still there. And so compatibility with beneficial organisms is very, very important within an IPM program. So Naturalis is compatible with a range of different biological controls, and Bavaria bassiana and generally entomopathogenic funguses and a lot of biopesticides are well integrated into biological control programs. So often what growers might say is, you know, if for example, with some of the contact acting fatty acid products, if it's knocking down things like aphid effectively, surely it's going to have an effect on your macrobiological controls, and it will have some effect on them. It is going to knock some of them down, but it's not going to be in the same sense as, say, with a traditional chemical where it's systemic or translaminar, and the insects, the beneficial insects, are constantly exposed to it. This is going to be at one point a knockdown, and then you can go in and rebuild your population. So it's an effective way to create a program, but you do just have to keep in mind that there might be some detrimental effects. So potentially reapplying additional biocontrols either the following days or the following couple of days or the following week to ensure that you've got that population back up to an effective level is important. So thank you for your time. Obviously, there's quite a lot of detail that we've covered off, and you know, there's lots of different nuances for all the individual products. Obviously, with our kind of biopesticide ranges at Fargro, we're more than happy to answer any questions that you have on them, discuss how you can fit them into a program. We generally have tank mix lists available through our technical notes, so if you need those, we can hopefully get those over to you. But yeah, thank you for your time. And if you have any further questions, do either contact myself or Fargro Technical.